Hello, everybody. I'm delighted to be here. I'm a sociologist by profession, so I know that a lot of you in the room are very established and renowned economists, and I'm delighted that I have been invited. I had the opportunity to also kind of bring the insight and the insight of my project. Now, I know that a lot of my research would be based on European and UK data, but I think having spent now some months in Australia, and also I recently returned from a trip in Chile, I think a lot of like the research insights that I'll be talking about could actually be implemented and, you know, be considered in other societies as well. So I would argue during the course of this presentation that a lot of the results that, you know, and a lot of like the discussion that I will try to kind of lead can be, and a lot of the solutions can be implemented in other countries, not just in Europe. Okay, so I've been asked to talk about social cohesion and, you know, the threat that is actually diversity and migration pose to social cohesion. And having done some research in Oldham, which was one of the places in the UK where you had race riots in 2003 and in 2005, I found that when we went there as a research team and we tried to talk to people about what social cohesion is, people really struggled with the concept. They'll talk about social cohesion as if it was a small dog. They said, well, you know, it's something good, it's something fluffy, and, you know, make us feel warm. I was like, but really, like, what is it for you? And they was like, yeah, something good, but we can't really narrow it down. So before anything else, like, I want to really, like, you know, come back to this idea. What do we mean by social cohesion? Because that would give an idea what the difficulties are. And the difficulties are there. So if you look at the definitions, and, you know, one of the most adopted definitions, we are talking about a lot of things, about the well-being of the members of a society, that, you know, come together to solve common problems, to stand against marginalization of individual members. It is about creating a sense of belonging. It is about improving conditions over time, promotes trust, promotes social mobility. So in a way, the problem, even, you know, from the beginning, from the definition, is that we have like this hot pot. We have a variety of ingredients that, you know, would constitute the hot pot, but maybe you like one based on more meat and you like one based on more vegetables. So we all have these individual preferences, what we put in. And when we have a fuzzy concept as that, you know, for policymakers, it's kind of hard to kind of come on the ground and practical solutions that will satisfy everybody. And not only that, it's very easy to put and to play an attributional blame game. So when something, you know, goes wrong, we usually, both as researchers and policymakers, we try to act fast. It's like, okay, what is the factor? Can we isolate one factor? And the problem is that there are a lot of factors. There are a lot of things that could go wrong at the community, at the neighborhood level. You have a variety of actors that operate together at any given time. So it is quick, like, when there is like this call for blood, you know, to create a boogeyman. And I feel that in more recent times, immigration has become, in a way, a sort of like the thing that both politicians and individual residents would put their finger to. But that also creates problems because, you know, if you think, okay, maybe diversity is a problem, well, how do you go about solving that? Is it about, you know, sending people back home? Is it not letting other people in? Is it controlling them? Is it controlling their cultural preferences, their societal preferences? So it's not very easy because, you know, essentially you are not reducing the complexity, you are multiplying it by isolating these factors. So it always pays off to really understand what's behind these problems. Okay, so how does, you know, diversity start? Well, diversity usually starts with a migration journey. And if you're a lucky one, you'll probably arrive on a plane, as we see now with a lot of the refugee crisis and a lot of other crises around the world. So, you know, we're not talking about also Europe, what is happening, in fact, with Venezuela and a lot of other countries. People may have, like, a variety of journeys, and some might be much more perilous journeys. And these journeys would stay with them and could very much transform their path and the way they interact with the host and the receiving society. So if, you know, if somebody has come on this boat as a refugee, are we expecting them to integrate and to adapt to a society in the same rate as an economic migrant that would come with the different set of qualifications that would be much more selected, both in terms of health, motivations, and their educational qualifications? Well, I don't think so in a lot of these cases. So a lot of, you know, of these migration waves, they comes and transforms different neighborhoods. So in the UK, like, you know, we can start with a neighborhood, let's say, pretty much like this. So imagine that your house in the middle, you are white British, everybody else has been white British. All of a sudden, with the coming of migration, well, some houses are now occupied by people that are different from you, that are others from you. And that creates some change, and creates change that people can perceive indeed as changing. In fact, in certain cases, you may even end up with neighborhoods like that, in which you are the isolated group. You're no longer the majority. You belong now to, in fact, a minority within that neighborhood. So it's easy then to ask the question, you know, which one of these scenarios represents a cohesive community? So can we point, you know, an ideal, is there like ideal scenario in which everybody is 50-50? If, you know, if I want to give practical solutions to a big problem, what is it? Like, how should neighborhoods look like in order for them to be really cohesive, in order for them to really operate well? And I think, as we've seen by Brexit, you know, this question, okay, is that like the really cohesive community, the one that, you know, I'm only surrounded by in-groupers, people like me, or, you know, and is the one at the bottom the least cohesive one? You know, Brexit kind of turned that question on its head. Because what happened is that, and I've plotted here, in fact, the most, the highest levels of communities in Britain, like in terms of local authority areas, they have the highest proportions of white British. And these are Allerdale, Staffordshire, Moorland, Redcar, and Copeland. And as you see, like from the map, they're primarily, you know, in the northeast or in the northwest in Britain. And what, you know, came about in with Brexit is that the majority of this community voted Leave. And it was a very high turnout as well. So, you know, increasingly people were talking of turnouts like there are more than 70% in the, you know, in a lot of these communities. They did not feel that they're part of the project. In fact, a lot of the news kind of coverage from Redcar showed people actively going on the street and saying there are a lot of problems. We don't feel that this is a cohesive society anymore. And this is not a place where you have any diversity. You know, you would hardly find any immigrant on the street. So it's not like, you know, only in a way about migration. Then you have other communities, the communities, again, according to Census 2011 in Britain, that are the most diverse. So invariably, they're based in London, although we have like one in kind of, you know, in the central Midland areas as well. And you'd find that a lot of these places voted Remain. And they overwhelmingly, so again, they had a lot of like kind of good turnout, and they voted to stay in the EU. And you also have, like, I haven't plotted those, but you had places like Birmingham, so in places where you have like kind of well-educated white British people that, as Merlin said, that there would be, you would suspect as a researcher that there would be an opposition, there would be a fight for resources, a conflict, and places like Birmingham and Ealing, in a way show that this is not the case. Like they can still vote, remain, they can still, you know, even living under conditions of diversity, feel part of a common project. So I think like we need to think much more about the resilience of certain communities. So why certain communities you have a lot of tensions, and why in certain ones you don't have that much tension? And the way we, you know, as a sociologist, so we're trying to reduce the complexity, right, to provide like different solutions. And we have tried to, you know, think about economic integration. So think about whether if people are employed, you know, there are different aspects of integration. Maybe people that are mostly integrated create cohesive communities. So let's think about economic integration, and this is indeed what my project is about. So you can, you know, think about in terms of economic integration that maybe one way to control this, if you're a policymaker, is to decide who should you let in. And there is this idea that, okay, maybe you have like a ladder and you have like the majority member that is somewhere kind of, let's say, on the top of the ladder, and then maybe EU migrants or other migrants within the EU are slightly below, but they have better prospects of catching up, so they're somewhere in the top. If you're an economic migrant in general, you're more selected, you're more positively selected, and so, you know, you're further up on the ladder. And then you have family migrant refugees that are, you know, less, you know, likely to be performing well in terms of the economic ladder. Now, I would question whether we even need, you know, to think, okay, you know, in terms of family migrants and refugees, we know by default, because of the journeys that I mentioned, that they would not do, they're not coming for economic reasons. So in a way, like when migration policy discusses this, we need to keep that in mind. Like we need to keep the journey with which these people have come into mind. And the statistics does show that there are these differences. It does show that on average, in terms of employment probability, in terms of transitions to work, family and refugee migrants are doing much worse in Europe as a whole, that economic and EU migrants. So they are doing much better. However, there is a huge variation between countries. So if you think of Europe as being homogeneous in terms of the countries, this is not the case. You have places like Sweden and Norway, there is no significant gap between economic migrants and refugee and family migrants. So they're obviously doing something good. And then you have countries like Greece, like UK, in which you have huge gaps, and refugees are doing much less well than, for example, economic migrants. So even in Europe, you don't have like homogeneity. There are huge differences. So, you know, we need to think like why in certain countries and why not others? Like what can we learn from the countries in which the gaps are smaller? And this is still 2014. So this does not include the newest, because we don't have the data. But, you know, it will be interesting to see what happens. Okay, so the question, do migrants undercut majority members? And, you know, you pointed out, and a lot of people said, well, we know from economic research that migration is good overall. It's good for the average. Well, I'll tell you, like, we just wrote a paper with Walter Zweisen on the UK using longitudinal data that there is actually evidence of undercutting. But it's not who you suspect it to be. It's not the well-educated and the most deprived area, you know, living white British. It's the second generation Black Caribbean and Black African that have been undercut in a way that we find in terms of the quality of their work, in terms of like the stability of their contracts by the incoming wave of migrants and the European migration. So there is, you know, some evidence of undercutting. You find that deprivation is a much more powerful predictor, in fact, of how well you do in the labor market than the share of migrants. By far. And yet there is something about the duration of unemployment. So the duration of unemployment, there is an association of increased share of migrants, especially in very deprived area, and increased duration of unemployment even for white British. So we still, you know, I would agree that there is a lot of things that we still need to think about. One of the things that I need to mention, although it's not particularly done in our project, is about the minimum wage. So if you ask a lot of people and a lot of politicians, they say, oh, we're against illegal migrants, but we're very happy to take all the migrants that come legally in the country. And I say, that's good. Uphold minimum wage and actually, like, you know, uphold the conditions of the legality as well of admitting migrants legally in your country. Now, if you look at the select committees and in a lot of like kind of the discussions, then a lot of the politicians say, well, but there is also the employers' lobby, and they say that, you know, they want people, that they need people. What are we doing about that? I mean, if you have been on the elected on this promise, and you know, we want to do, in Britain there was a huge Wagamama scandal in which they found that about 500 employees were not paid the minimum wage. They came up with an excuse that these, you know, they were expected that people would buy their own uniforms. They were just shamed. There was nobody that was actually actively fined. And, you know, there hasn't been for quite some time. So what should politicians prioritize? Well, I'm a sociologist. I do believe that it's education. I do think that it's quite staggering that if you see the returns to tertiary degrees, so to university education, not only migrants are doing less well than the majority in Europe, but also the second generation. So, you know, you can say, okay, the migrants, they will need time to adjust, time to adapt. However, if the second generation is also arguably experiencing quite huge gaps compared to the majority member, you know, even in countries such as meritocratic countries in Europe, then we do have a problem. And finally, we should, and I, you know, I want to bring the question about discrimination back. So one of the things that we do in GEM is that we have these field experiments. And we do them in Spain, the Netherlands, Germany, Norway, and the UK. And what we find is that consistently, if you have a Muslim name, you would be about, and these are all significant differences, you'll be 1.13 times less likely to be called back in Germany. You'll be less likely to be called back in Netherlands, in Norway, in the UK. Only in Spain, you won't have a significant difference from somebody that has like a native sounding name. Moreover, if you say, if you signal on your CV that you have been somehow, you know, relatedly or you're engaged in a religious activity, so you helped in the mosques or you try to organize like, you know, in your neighborhood, there is a penalty further to the Muslim name. So, you know, compared to somebody with a Muslim name, you'd still be less likely to be called back for a job. So there is an extra penalty if you actually say that you're involved in this religious activity. So the specter of discrimination is not entirely not out there. We've made huge gains, but that should not make us, you know, sit back. And Devas Pager's work also in Harvard also shows that in the US you have that hierarchy. If you are black in the US, as her research shows, with no criminal record, you'll still be less likely to be called back for work compared to a white person with a criminal record. Now, that is, you know, that is quite striking. Okay, so to wrap up, what are the policy recommendations? So don't play, you know, the attributional blame game. This is what, whenever I go to policy meetings, I always say, it is easy to create boogeyman. Don't play that. There was this something very interesting happened in Bradford 2 years ago. Around Christmas time, there was a fight for Christmas trees. And, you know, the Daily Mail came with the headlines, oh my gosh, another fight, riots in Bradford. Well, it was like a celebration of multiculturalism. Everybody wanted to have a tree because it's nice to have it with lights and decorated. They just have miscalculated that also the Muslim community may want to put up a Christmas tree. So the way you spin different stories, the way you talk about these stories is part of the game. And, you know, you can choose not to play that game. And finally, I would say that it's still important to hold good examples. So there are a lot of communities, as I said, in which you have plenty of good examples of people living side by side, and we don't get to hear about those. We don't get to hear to go to the community, and we don't, you know, there are a lot of changes, there are technological changes, there are economic changes that are pervading our societies. The way we, you know, plan to work, where we're going to live and create homes have changed dramatically. So which communities are resilient should be of importance to us, and we should be actively studying them. And investing in human capital, it can never go awry. I mean, in my research, I show that even among refugees, so even well-skilled refugees benefit from further investments into their human capital. So it's not an easy thing to, you know, disaggregate and take like these things from the hot pot, but I think like we can make a concerned action that will benefit everybody. Thank you.